They're real great starters, but this is the real show today. Because this is God's show. This is the sacred liturgy. This is where He comes most intimately into our lives. And I'm happy to be with you all. Just before we say this prayer together, just by means of introduction, you all know Deacon Greg here. He's your very own deacon of the parish and your main man for all things liturgical here at St. Mary's. And for those of you who may not have met me yet, I'm Deacon Sam Morehead. I was ordained a deacon this last April, and I'm en route to the priesthood, and I'll be ordained a priest on May 12th at the cathedral by somebody. I have no idea who that's going to be right now, so your guess is as good as mine. But I was just in Philadelphia to drop off a care package to the people of Philadelphia. His name is Charles Shapiro. And the people of Philadelphia thanked me, and they thank you for the gift. So anyway, he's off well. So we're praying for a new archbishop. And in this time, we're also praying for God's will to be done as we implement a new translation of the Roman Missal. It's a moment that's really exciting for the whole church, but particularly for the church in America. And so as we delve into that and look at the good thing that God is doing here in our midst, let's start by saying a prayer together. There's this wonderful holy card, a beautiful, it's actually my favorite image. In the, it's called the Mystical Adoration of the Lamb. And on the back side is a prayer that we've written for the Archdiocese of Denver to help us, to have God help us in this work. So let's pray together. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Eternal Father, we worship you and we give you thanks as we humbly come before you in prayer and supplication. As the Church in Denver begins a new era of liturgical renewal with the implementation of the third edition of the Roman Missal, we pray, Lord, you open the hearts of your faithful to the beauty and splendor of the sacred liturgy. Send your Holy Spirit to guide our preparations. Grant us the grace to deepen our understanding of the great gift and mystery of the holy sacrifice of the Mass, the Supper of the Lamb. For the glory of the most holy and undivided Trinity, may the new English translation enable us to truly sing a new song to the Lord with fitting worship and praise. May the Blessed Virgin Mary's humility, trust, and perfect union with Christ be the model for our prayer. Amen. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This prayer captures in a beautiful way kind of what this is all about. We see in it these beautiful words such as, I'm not saying it right, beauty and splendor, gift and mystery, fitting worship and praise, because that's what we're all about. We are striving to be God's holy people, and He has called us into a beautiful relationship with Him, and He's enabled us to do the most awesome and amazing thing possible, and that's to worship Him. And sometimes, I like to just step back and say, who am I to worship God? I mean, I, this little, minuscule, tiny, itsy-bitsy kind of an ant of a thing, and yet I'm called, all of us are called to worship God. And the beautiful thing, too, is we can worship God with our own language, with our own tongue, in very human ways. We don't have to kind of go on some esoteric, you know, spaced out, drug-induced trips or anything. No, it's very easy in one hand. And the church is trying to find a way to make it an even richer, more fulfilling experience. And that is why we're here tonight. We're here to talk about the implementation of a new translation of the Roman Missal. The Roman Missal, right off the front, right off the bat, that's just the book on the altar the priests pray out of. So you've probably seen it. It's the little red book that always kind of moves between the chair where the priest is and the altar. That book, sometimes called a sacramentary, is the Roman Missal, and it is how we pray the Mass. The Mass, which is the most beautiful, it's the central of all Catholic prayers. So that's what we're here tonight to talk about. And so here's a little preview of what we're going to hopefully do this evening. And so, first of all, the first question, why is the Church retranslating the sacramentary? I think it's a decent question. You can say, we have a book already, isn't it good enough? I mean, we've been praying out of it about 30 plus years. So there's a reason why the church is proposing something new to us this year. Secondly, ask yourself, how will I be affected by this new translation? Because it's going to affect us all. A third question is, after the deacons have done their bit up here, what if I still have questions? I mean, what if this is still some impenetrable mystery? And then finally, what do I do from here? Where do we go? Because this is coming. It's a gift that's coming to us in November, and we should be prepared to receive it. And so it's going to require some steps on our behalf to get ready for the gift and to embrace the gift. So let's begin by taking up that first question. What brought us to this moment? Why is the church doing this? A brief history of the church's liturgical tradition is in order for this. So I get to do the honor of taking us on the journey down memory lane. Now, some of you may have a little bit broader memory than me. I'm not calling you old. I'm just saying it's broader. But for those of us who are very young and handsome, it's important for us to have a memory of all these things that have happened over the last number of years. So here is kind of a brief overview of our tradition. And you see, I've very purposefully chosen our images. This is the beginning, and this is us now, or at least the Pope now. It's not quite us, but it's pretty good. So where is the beginning? The beginning of the Mass. That's what we're talking about. Well, it is our central, firm Catholic belief that Christ instituted the Mass at the Last Supper. At the Last Supper, he gave us the gift of his body and blood under the appearances of bread and wine, and it's the same event as the mystery of the cross and resurrection. So when we receive Holy Communion, that which looks like bread and that which looks like wine, we receive the very body and the blood of Jesus Christ, the body and blood crucified on the cross, risen from the dead and giving us life today. And so we touch Jesus himself. So Jesus intended this, and he initiated this at the Last Supper, when he said, "Do this in memory of me." Now, we know that this happened. The church took up this mandate, "Do this in memory," from the earliest days. We can look back, and we have books that date back all the way to the early days of the church. We can read the writings of saints from the very first century who describe what the Mass looked like. And some of those writings are telling. They say they gather together. There's a priest who presides. They begin by reading from Scripture. The priest gives an explanation of what was read in Scripture. And then they celebrate the Eucharist. It sounds exactly what we do today. So it's an unbroken tradition for 20 centuries. But the church has been very careful in how she hands this down. She passes it down. She doesn't just take the sacred liturgy, this worship of God, lightly. She's always safeguarded it, and the way she's done that is she's put it in books, these books we call sacramentaries or missals, because it probably wouldn't be the best idea if we had somebody, you know, some silly, young, handsome deacon up there just making up whatever he wanted to do. I mean, that would get really off the tracks quickly. And so the church has given us an indication of what we're to do, how we're to worship God, and that's our proud tradition. And so the history of the liturgy, the history of the church, has been marked also by this slow, organic development. We can't say that we celebrate the Mass today exactly like they celebrated it in the first century of the Apostles. They don't. I mean, they didn't speak English in the first century of the Apostles. So we know that there is this, at once, an unbroken tradition running from Christ through the Apostles down through every generation to the present. The Mass is the Mass. It's always been the Mass. It always will be the Mass. It is the sacrifice of Jesus. It is his body and blood. But we know that it can take new and different and organically evolving forms to every generation. Now, those of you who I said have a little broader memory than myself, you might remember well when the Mass was completely celebrated in Latin, when the priest stood at the altar, which was facing, everybody faced in the same direction. I like to say it that way more than the priest turned his back to us. But the priest faced in the same direction, and people didn't understand anything. More often than not, what you heard were clinking rosaries of the people in the pew, you know, not knowing what was going on, but something's going on. Oh, there must be Jesus. There was so much beauty in that tradition. But the church also knew that we needed to appreciate the tradition. We needed to appreciate the Mass for what it is. And so the gift of the Second Vatican Council was to make the Mass more accessible to us. And it is in that tradition, in that line, that the church is doing this whole new project of retranslating the Mass today. And we'll look at that in a moment. So, the next question is, taking up that matter of what was the gift of the Second Vatican Council? Oh, look at you. What a pious celebration. So the Second Vatican Council had a principle that said must be considered above all else. And that was the full, actual, and conscious participation of the people. Now, some of you might be saying, well, I've not heard that. I've heard something else. Sometimes it was translated full, active, and conscious participation of the people. But Pope Benedict, a couple years ago, said, well, there was a translation error that happened between the Latin and the English. Because he said, the Mass is not about just a whole bunch of activity. It's not about everybody having a job and, you know, having to do something all the time. It's about actually entering in, understanding, meditating, singing, you know, praying through what is happening at the altar. It's an actual participation, not a virtual participation. And at the same time it said we need to have this kind of rich participation, the Second Vatican Council fully affirmed the role of Latin in the life of the church. See, there are some people who say the church just got rid of Latin. We did away with it, we threw it away, it was broken, it's a dead language, let's bury it. No, the church said our tradition is a Latin tradition. We are the Latin church. I mean, you have the Eastern Rite churches that have their different Greek and other languages, Russian, but we are the Latin church, even in Littleton, Colorado. And so the official text of everything that the church puts out, from the Mass to the Catechism to all documents signed by the Pope, everything out of Rome is in Latin still. And, you know, amazingly, there are people who still speak Latin fluently. I don't know who they are, but, you know, I actually have a friend who's a priest, and he goes to Chicago every year, and they have a Latin-speaking conference. I'm like, you must get a life. but the church's language is Latin, so we appreciate it. It's rich, and there's a place for it still. And sometimes we even hear it still. Sometimes at Mass, we hear the original languages. In fact, there's some Greek that survives. We hear the Kyrie eleison. That's the Greek for Lord have mercy. We say Kyrie eleison, and Christe eleison, Christe eleison, Christ have mercy. That's Greek. Those are from the earliest days of the church. And then some of these Latin terms, even if we're not frequently praying in Latin, some of these terms still make sense to us. We pray the Gloria every Sunday. That's glory to God in the highest. Well, Gloria makes sense. And, you know, even we see it on Christmas cards all the time, Gloria Excelsis Deo. I mean, some of these Latin things are still with us. They're important. So Latin's important. But the church at the Second Vatican Council said there's a beauty to our vernacular traditions, to embracing the people's local languages, English, in our case, for most of us here. So they opened the doors to praying in our mother tongues. At the same time it did all this, it said for us to go forward, to have a deeper appreciation of the Mass, for us to appreciate the Latin, for us to use vernacular languages, we need to also rework the Roman Missal, the very structure of it. So the truth is, our book, the actual, what's in it, the prayers we pray, the gestures we do, though it's a lot the same, it's two different books from before the Second Vatican Council and after the Second Vatican Council. By the mere fact that we have more readings. It used to be, in the older Mass, you just had a first reading, which was almost never from the Old Testament. Catholics almost never heard readings from the Old Testament. You had a psalm, but it was usually two verses, never a whole psalm. And then you did the gospel. And all of that, of course, was in Latin, and then they would repeat it all to you in English, you'd have the readings twice. And then, with the reforms of the Second Vatican Council, we got a whole bunch of scripture opened up to us, things that we'd never heard in the Catholic tradition, but that we've always said are Holy Scripture, the Old Testament. And then we have the responsorial psalms, where we're getting a lot more of the psalms prayed in at larger pieces. The second reading is always usually from Paul or the Acts of the Apostles. And then we have the three-year cycle, so we're hearing more of scriptures altogether out of the Gospels. In in that work of giving us a new Mass, it was originally written in Latin, like everything else. And so we have different names for it. Some call it the Mass of Pope Paul VI. Some call it the Novus Ordo, because of the new order, Novus Ordo, of the Mass. So there's different terms for it. Some call it the Mass of Vatican II. I mean, there's different expressions. But it started in Latin, and it had to then be translated into every language in the world. Now, that was a big project, and the church was very eager to get it out in the hands of the priests and the people, so it was a very quick project. It was done with a lot of haste. And it was done with some principles of translation that we wouldn't hold so highly today. Not that the Mass was bad by any means. It wasn't. It's holy. It's the Mass. It's the words the church gives us, the words of Jesus, the words of the sacraments. But it wasn't as good as it could have been. And so the church has said, we need to reappreciate that. So let's look back at what happened then. To do the work of translation, the bishops of all the English-speaking countries, here, Canada, England, Australia, etc., they formed this group called the Commission on English and the Liturgy, or International Commission for English and Liturgy, called ISIL. And their job was just to do work of translation. They're a translating firm for the church. That was in 63. In 69, The Novus Ordo, this new Mass, the Roman Missal, was published in Latin. So 69, the new Mass is out, because in 63 they already saw it coming. In 74, the first full English sacramentary, which they always almost look like this, I mean, it's kind of this is what they look like on the altar, this came out in 74. And this is what we've been using since 1974. In 75, though, almost nobody knows this, so I'm letting you in on a secret. 75, the church published a second edition of the Missal in Latin, and it never got translated into English. So already you can see that between 69 and 75, the church is saying, okay, we've already got to make revisions, not to the vernaculars, but to the Latin. So we're working in the U.S. off of that first edition that went out, that got outdated basically in 1 year. And we've been doing it ever since. And then in 2001, Pope John Paul II, Blessed John Paul II, who's so much a part of what we're doing here at the Catechesis, he published a document called Liturgium Authenticum, which said, okay, we were a little hasty with our translations. There were some things that were missed, some theology that could be brighter, crisper, better preserved, better reflected. We need to do a work of retranslation in every country. It's not just America, it's not just English-speaking countries, it's every country. It just happens that the English-speaking ones are the first to bat. Now, some people, why? You know, we're not, everybody say, what, Italian should go first, that's where, you know, the Rome is. No, they said the most important is the English-speaking countries. Because the truth is, though you're supposed to do these translations from Latin to English, there's a lot of countries in the world, parts of Africa and Asia, where the church is not very, very large or vibrant, but the church is there and they need translations. And nobody in those countries, nobody in the church, is good at Latin. So I was, I don't know, not scandalized, that's too much, but I found out that a whole lot of these little countries just always look to the English. They do whatever the English Missal says and translate it into their local country. So if the English Missal has mistakes, that mistake's gonna go all over the world. So it's important, the church said, that we do the English Missal first and get it right. Get it to be the best it can be. And so, here's another thing. In 2002, the church published a third edition in Latin. So we already have three editions. The church is on her third edition, and in America, we're still on the first edition. And changes have happened between the three. Not big changes, but things that are important. Some prayers changed. And a whole lot of saints have been added to this Missal that we don't find in the old Missal. So it's important that we would add those in. I mean, they're saints we should be celebrating. So, where do we go from there? Let's talk a little bit about that work of translation, because there were two things at work. This, when I made this, he was still Archbishop of Denver, so. But we have our apostolic administrator. That's what we're now referring to Bishop Conley as. He's an apostolic administrator. Back then, they had a principle of translation called dynamic equivalence. It was more poetic than what we would do today, but it was much looser. and it was made in haste. So the sense was, okay, so here's the Latin. Latin is an old-fashioned, cumbersome language. We don't have to be super slavish and just getting the exact words down. Let's get a feel for the words. Let's kind of get a taste for what it was saying. And if we kind of miss some things and don't put them in there, well, that's okay. We're getting a feel for it. Think of this principle and of what happened there when we come a little bit later and talk about the Gloria. In the Gloria, glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth, there, you know, we worship you, we praise you, we give you thanks. In the original Latin, it's laudamus te, adoramus te, benedicimus te, glorificamus te. Well, I never heard in that English translation, what do we say we glorify God? I mean, certain things, the feel is there. I mean, that's what they said. And so there was a certain, yes, the feel was there. But certain things were just, you know, a little looser. Now today, we would refer to the work of translation that really isn't all that new. It's just kind of a very, at once traditional, but also very contemporary work of translation. We call it formal equivalence. And this is not the church just saying, let's be fuddy-duddy and old-fashioned and, you know, be uber-traditional. This is the principle of translation that is popular in all the universities right now as well. So, you know, if for fear that, oh no, we're going back to the slavish, like, strict Latin translation, no, I mean, this is what the secular universities would look to now and how they would do works of translation from old languages, from Latin to modern English. What are the advantages of this formal equivalence, of a more a close translation, we might say? It captures the more exact meaning and the feel of the original ancient Latin text. Mind you, most of our prayers in the Missal go back to at least the 7th or 8th century. So if they were written in Latin in the 7th or 8th century, it'd be kind of nice, just, I mean, I think, to get a feel for them, what it would sound like in English in the 21st century. It's more scriptural. They have worked hard in the translation to bring out the scriptural references that are in the Latin but that were glossed over in the English. It's more historical, it's more precise theologically, and this is the fruit of a 10-year process. This was not kind of that hasteful post-Vatican II thing. The bishops have been working on this since 2001, and here we are in 2011. So what are the features of the new Missal that we're gonna have in our parishes, including here at St. Mary's, beginning in the month of November? We'll have better translations of all of the parts of the Mass, the ordinary prayers that we hear every day, every Sunday. That would be like the glory to God in the highest. The Creed. One of the things we're going to find out is, you know, the Creed begins, with a, you know, little broader memory than myself. It used to begin, Credo in Unum Deum. Now, I've studied a little bit of Latin, maybe some of you did too. Credo is, I believe. But in English, we've been saying, we believe. There's nothing super wrong with that, but it's not what it says. The church always asks us at the Mass to make a very personal profession of faith, to stand up with everybody else and say, I believe in one God. So we're going to have that in the Creed, the Eucharistic prayers, and even in the dismissal. And then also we have the proper prayers that you hear the priests pray at every Mass when they say, you know, let us pray. Those prayers will change to furthermore reflect the richness and the depth of the original Latin text. And then, as I said, we have some new saints' days and feasts coming back, coming because we've never had them because we're two missals behind. So what are some of those? The Holy Name of Jesus, Padre Pio, and now Blessed John Paul II. So we will get to have all of those in our liturgical life now with this new missal. And so what is our timeline between, you know, where we're at and where we're going? All of this, these texts and these proposals were approved by the various English-speaking bishops' conferences in 2009 at Central. And that was no easy matter. Just think, you had to get all of the Americans, the Irish, the English, the Scottish, the Australians, the Canadians, and not to mention India has a big English-speaking population. All of them had to agree. I mean, it was a miracle unto itself. And then the Vatican, Pope Benedict, gave permission, they call it recognition, in 2010. And this is him signing the document that gave this permission. in 2010. The U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops, USCCB for short, has already given us permission to start singing the parts that would be sung, and we can do that this month. And in fact, you'll find out later that there's going to be some practices coming up here at the parish to help us prepare to that work of singing, because one of the things, one of the consequences is all of the mass parts that we're used to are disappearing, because they're all the old text. Now, some of the composers have really tried hard to preserve the music, but have used the new text. But sometimes that's really hard. So we're going to have to learn some new music. And the full text, everything, fully, will be implemented in prayed beginning the first Sunday of Advent, my whole Advent wreath here, first Sunday of Advent of this year, the weekend after Thanksgiving. So enjoy your turkey, your stuffing, and get ready for a new Mass. It's really the same Mass, but it's just some newly polished English language. So here's what we're going to do next. Deacon Greg is going to lead us in a bit of an experience of what this all looks like. So it's a matter of experiencing the richness. And for this, you all have these parts of the Mass. So you'll see all of this on the screen, but you're also welcome to follow along in your bulletins as well.
Sam, I was after the first three presenters, it's like old folks home here. Contrary to what Deacon Sam was saying, I remember Latin. I lived that, and I was the one that saw the altar rotate. So exactly what you're talking about. So that's why I'm up here giving you the pre and the post. Before I begin, what I'd like to do. This put us in a frame of mind about what this change is all about in terms of how we should look at the Mass. And I'd like to read from a book called The Lamb's Supper by Scott Hahn. Some of you may have read that or not, but I'd recommend all of us get that, because if you really want to understand the Mass, it really puts it into focus. And he was really challenged in his spirituality and his understanding of faith. So he snuck into a Mass in the basement in a church in a chapel in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and he relates his first Mass that he attended. And I'd just like to say a few things here. As he begins, as the Mass moved on, however, something hit me. My Bible wasn't just beside me, it was before me. In the words of the Mass, one line was from Isaiah, another from Psalms, another from Paul. The experience was overwhelming. I wanted to stop everything and shout, "Hey, I can explain what's happening from Scripture. This is great." Still, I maintained my observer status. I remained in the sidelines until I heard the priest pronounce the words of consecration. "This is my body. This is the cup of my blood." Then he goes on, he says, "Then I felt all my doubt drain. As I saw the priest raise that white host, I felt a prayer surge from my heart in a whisper. My Lord and my God, that's really you." And he goes on and he explains a lot of these prayers that we pray are from Scripture. And I guess the one thing we'd ask that you do over the next, as we enter into the new prayers that we're going to pray, and they're not new, like Deacon Sam said, their terms and phrases have been updated to be more accurate. And as you hear these things, think about what I'm going to talk about are some of the things to think about as we hear these prayers, because every one of these prayers has some scriptural tie to it. And there's a lot of history that we Catholics, I think, have a tendency to shun. You know, we're so used to the repetition that we have over and over and over again. And maybe the familiarity, really, maybe it's too familiar to the point where we take it for granted. So that's why Scott Hahn, he really hit the nail on the head. It was so fresh to him. And that's the kind of the attitude that we need to take as we look at these changes. And there are more sources for you, but I'll go over those a little later. But let me begin. Like, Father, we've been talking about this for ever since we knew there was going to be a change, is as we said when I was younger, you know, the priest would say, Domus Vobiscum, and we would sit or they'd say, Dominic, who got the biscuits? And then we would say, Et cum spiritu tuo. And right now we say what? And also, what happened to spiritu? It went away. Because it makes it sound of an anchor a lot easier to say, and also with you. But what we've lost is that term spirit. And when the priest, it's almost a twofold approach. Some of us are vertically challenged. There we go. This twofold greeting by the priest in our response is really something very key to what the Mass is all about. Whereas the priest says, the Lord be with you. And he is honestly saying and sincerely saying that he wants the Spirit of the Lord to be with us in our hearts as we prepare to do the sacrifice of the Mass, to participate in it. And our response, and also with your Spirit, we are recalling the day that he was ordained and the Spirit came upon him. We're asking him, or we're praying that he, his Spirit will come forward, because he is in persona Christi. He is Christ at that Mass. So we are asking the Spirit to be with him, the Spirit of his vocation, to be with us that day. So as he's asking, you know, saying to us, let me the Lord be with you, we're saying, and also with your Spirit, the Spirit of your vocation, that's going to carry us through this sacrament. So it means more. It's not just the Spirit, you know, the your being or your spiritual being. It's actually the Spirit of that order. So the thing is that we need to, as we begin the Mass, is to really focus in on what we're doing. This little change that we see here. As we get into all these different changes that are occurring, you're going to see that even a single word can change what the meaning is. And that's really what we want to point out a few things tonight. Don't have time to do everything. But there's, behind those words that you see, you have the pre and the post. You know, we begin with the penitential rite. We talk about that, the confiteor. And there's actually three different penitential rites that we have authorization to do, but I'd just like to talk about the confiteor right now. And if you look, you see that, remember we used to say mea culpa, mea culpa, mea maxima culpa? And what happened to all the culpas? We lost two of them, by the way. So the church is bringing that back, and it's not, you know, even in those days, we would strike our breast three times. It's, you know, symbolizing a rock that was breaking the sin in our hearts. And it almost looks like that we're more sinful now. And all of a sudden, the church is saying, you know, you really need to ask for forgiveness. So, but we need to remember the guiding principle of this whole, the whole process is the conversion of the text. And it's a new translation that we're looking at that really expresses more gradually the seriousness of our sin. And if you look at sorrow or forgiveness, and just if you look at the gravity of it, you know, if I run into somebody at a grocery store, I'll say, excuse me, sorry. You know, when I do something that I make my wife mad, or to the point where I really hurt her, I mean, to the point where I'm literally in the doghouse, I really feel bad about it. So what I will say it in as many ways as I can. I'm sorry. I really didn't mean to do it. And I really please forgive me. What can I do? Can I take out the garbage? What can I do to make you feel better? There's a lot of truth to that. But the situation is that as we, if there's one being that we really offend, that we really should take seriously as when we offend God. So we want to make sure as we enter our liturgy that we want to make sure that we ask God for our total forgiveness. Even if we just went to confession, we want to ask Him, please forgive me. Through my fault, through my fault, through my most grievous fault, please forgive me. So it really opens up the door for us to enter into the church, if you will, to the Mass, so that we can now participate fully with a clean conscience, if you will. And if you'll notice, remember we used to call it acts or part, you know, prayer is adoration, contrition, thanksgiving, supplication. Remember that? We used to do those four, but prayer falls into those four categories. That's really what we're doing at the beginning of Mass here. You know, we were doing a contrition right here, and then with a glory we do a adoration, and then later on we do a thanksgiving, and then we at the end we ask for gifts and for things that we need. So the prayer of the Mass covers all the prayers that we could possibly ask for. So the Confiteor really brings us, cleanses our soul, if you would, and really lays out to God, I'm here. And I'm here because I love you and I'm sorry that I hurt you before I came here. So it kind of sets the table straight between God and ourselves. Change has been people of goodwill. And what this recalls is in Luke, the very, you know, the Christmas story with the opening line of the Gloria. Matter of fact, I know we used to always confuse the Protestant Christmas card versus the Catholic Christmas card, because when we say people of goodwill versus his people on earth, we thought the Protestants were wrong. We ended up adapting it in the new liturgy, or the old liturgy, and now we're back to the Catholic way of doing it, which is really obviously the Latin. But if you look at it, we're looking at the text as when you say his people on earth, we're really talking about whom people belong to. And we're talking about a goodwill, we're talking about the quality of the people. It has a different look, and that's really what we're talking about is who are all we that are entering into this. And we're really praising God. This is what it's all about. Like I said, it's we praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. We add a whole litany of praises to God. So I say this is a praise type of a prayer. And you look at the old text that says, well, Almighty God, Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Whereas the new prayer really is, we praise you, we bless you, we adore you, glorify you, we give you thanks. All these things you could possibly think of. You know, it does sound redundant, if you will, or it says like, it almost seems excessive. But that's the point about this, is that we want to show the God we really, we're very thankful that He has allowed us to be here. So we take this time out to give glory to God. And these changes that have occurred, like I said, they're very poignant in terms of, as we do this prayer, say this prayer, we'll end up being in the frame of mind that we are people of goodwill. We're here because we want to be here. We really have good intentions. And we praise you for allowing us to be here. So this is a very good following prayer from the Confiteor that gives us a chance to really get into in a prayerful mode of praising and adoration of God. And so this little change that they have there in terms of the adding all of these glorifications really emphasizes that point. And also, we're talking about, if you go down, it says, only Son of the Father. That's what I wanted to see. You see, here it says, only Son of the Father versus the only begotten Son. It adds that word, only begotten, as opposed to just the Son of the Father. And all of us believers are called to a special relationship with God. You know, we, you know, as adopted sons and daughters of God, we have a special relationship with God. Through our baptism, we become a child of God. But the relationship with the Father and the Son is totally different because he was begotten. He was divine. So this shows the Son of the Father that, well, I'm a son of the Father. You know, I'm an adopted son of the Father. So once again, the translation really distinguishes the only begotten Son. In other words, Jesus is the divine Son. He's from the Father. And the term that's used in terms of the Latin is unigenite is in caps. And you'll notice in your text it's in capitalization, only begotten. Because that's the word, the single term for only begotten is unigenite, which is really, a title that's given to Jesus. So it's these little subtle things that, as you read them in your pews, when you see only begotten Son like that, when you see it in caps, that's not just a simple adjective, only begotten. It is a title. So once again, I said it's these little subtle things that really have a lot of impact. Now the one prayer that is probably the ones with the most changes is the creed, which will soon follow the glory. Come on. There we go. Okay. This is rather long. I want to just highlight a couple things that really you're going to find out as you pray, already seeing that there are some major changes in terms of verbiage. I'd like to begin with the, let's see here, the obvious thing, which was already mentioned by Deacon Sam. Now, what do you notice immediately?
I we.
That's the beginning. It was like Deacon Sam was saying, the credo in Latin is I believe. And the thing that really stands out here is that, and he had mentioned this to a certain extent, is that we are ourselves are committing to God. We're the ones that are doing the believing. We're not hiding behind our fellow congregation when we say we. You know, really it should be, well, most of us are, but we have an opportunity to say I. And it's just like our you've been at a baptism lately or the Paschal Vigil, where we do the special creed where do you reject Satan, do you reject all his evil works, and go on and on, and do you believe in God the Father, and Son. What do we do after each one of those?
I do.
So we commit to that that particular prayer, which is a form of a creed. But that's really what we're doing every Sunday, or attempt or mass, where we have the creed, is I am making a commitment to you, God. So this is really gives us an opportunity, and once again, those prayers, which we just, they come automatic, is when we say that word, I, it would be great for every mass that you hear this loud, I, and then the rest of the words. So that we sincerely commit to the things that we're saying. So that's a really, talk about a major change, but that's probably the most poignant change. The only thing they actually had one eye. If you look at the credo, it says this credo, I believe, and then it goes throughout. And it's in and. They did where it says and. They just go right into I again. So that's one subtle change that they made, which is, I guess, a poetic license, if you will. There are a couple other things that want to go over here really quick. Let's just go right on to the big word, the multi-syllable. Can we all say that word together?
Consubstantial.
What does that mean? Well, we got a plan, the audience. One of one substance. Okay. Actually, look it up in the online sometimes, you'll actually see it's a unique relationship between God the Father and Son. That's one definition that comes up in. Just to give you some history, why we're using that word now versus one in being. When the fourth century, we had what's called the Council of Nicaea. I'll get to find another part. Or lose the virtues. While he's doing that, there was a series.
We lost
it. Okay, well, we got handouts here. We can use that. There were a series of heresies that really were dividing Christians. This is about the fourth century. And one particular one was Arius. He said at the time that there was a time when the Son did not exist. So there really a clarification of, was Jesus really the Son of God? If he was, how was he evolved? How did he become the Son of God? So the Council of Nicaea specifically forged the vocabulary that really articulated carefully that what we believe in our church. Nate shows the word consubstantial. In Latin, it's consubstantialis, which is obviously part of that. So we had used that word since. That's always been in the creed, that particular word. Because it specifically points to the fact that Jesus was. He has a unique relationship between the Father and the Son, and that he's always been with the Father. He is God. And so from he always was God, and then when he became man, he took on another being. But there's no time in his earthly life that he became God, because he always was. So that's the one issue that they wanted to really bring out in this particular council, and it became the Nicene Creed. And it describes a very unusual thing that the nature of Jesus Christ, that's not like anything else we know. I mean, word, have you ever used that word? Talking to somebody? This water is really consubstantial. We don't use that word in our vernacular. But guess what? November 27th, we're going to use that word. And it's going to take a while to get used to it. But you got 2 months to practice that. Every time you brush your teeth at night, it comes to mind. Does everybody understand that? It's what word came from. It's not like we're saying, what can we throw in there that'll really screw up? No, that's not what it's all about. It's to get more substance. And that, there's no greater word that, that can really explain that. We could say Jesus having the same substance. Well, what does that mean? To us, it's deeper because it's a unique relationship between God the Father and God the Son. Okay, how are we doing here? Let's see, we're on the creed. There's a couple other things in the creed that you might be interested in. Is the word incarnate versus born. What does incarnate mean to you?
Not of human form.
You know, it's means given into flesh in terms of the Latin version of it. And it professes that the Word became flesh in the womb of the Virgin Mary. Not when he was born, but excuse me, the moment of conception. That's when he took on flesh, became a human being, as opposed to just being born. Now when we hear the word born, well, that means that when he's after 9 months. That's not a true interpretation converting the Latin to that. So they wanted to make sure that, you know, the current translation, the irony of the whole situation is we've been seeing these things over the years really open to potential questions when they say things like that. So this really closes the loop, if you will. There's no more loopholes. We have this totally definitive words now that really make it more substantial. One other thing I wanted to cover. I wanted to look at the very end of the creed. And I think this is almost part of our creed. In other words, it's almost a, do you really believe this? At the end it says, I look for, well, actually they didn't highlight here, but the last sentence in the present text, it says, we look for the resurrection. And the new text says, I look forward to the resurrection. Oh, wow. I'm actually looking forward to this. You know, as opposed to, we look for the resurrection. To sit, you know, in the back of your heart waiting for Jesus to, he's already left us, but I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. So I'm really anticipating this. I can hardly wait until this happens. So this, we say all these things, I believe. And then we say, you know what, I believe this so much, I'm looking forward to it. And that word forward, I look forward, really this has quite an impact on the creed. So it kind of summarizes the whole creed and says, I really believe this. God, I can hardly wait to be with you. So the new creed is really has some major things. This is to be the one that's going to take us a lot to learn. With the cards in the pews, you're probably going to use those the most just for the creed. But if you take this home over the next couple months, just read this and just, not so much memorize it, but just look at the words. I mean, things like things visible and invisible versus seen and unseen. What's the big deal there? I mean, something that's seen and unseen. Well, I haven't seen my great-grandfather, but he has been visible, or he's invisible now. You know, the saints and the angels, I've never seen them, but they're invisible to us, as opposed to they've been seen by other people. So these words really are becoming more and more precise. Okay, let's see what else we got here. We need to... one thing I want to just kind of throw a side note here is these are changes and words that we're going to have to learn and that we are going to speak in our responses. But the priests, their whole, all the Eucharistic prayers, their prefaces, everything they read now is going to be brand new. So is there 9 Eucharistic prayers, I think, Father? Some priests have memorized those. Well, sorry, they'll be right with us. But the thing I challenge all of us to do is to listen to those new prayers, to really see the way they're written, the way they're pronounced. The sentences are going to be longer, but the verbiage is so alive. Now, there's a term in one of them, to do like. The term do like, what does that mean? So it really makes us think and listen to what our priests are going to be reading during the Eucharistic prayers, all of the prayers that they say. I'd like to go to the Sanctus and highlight a couple things there. And then we move on here. Where do you see the change there?
God of hosts.
God of hosts. What's a host?
So we receive.
It's a what? Multitude of what?
People.
Not
and maybe church
of Okay, we're getting warm here. If you go into Isaiah, it talks about the time where he had a dream, he saw heavenly hosts, seraphim, angels that were adoring God. And what they said was, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God of hosts." They were praising him, admiring him. So when we added the term host, what it refers to, and this goes back to the Hebrew and the Latin, used the word Sabaoth. And the term Sabaoth refers to that the power of God is so great that it can control all the greatest beings, which are angels. So he has that strength and power. It's beyond just being God of power and might. It's beyond that. So it ratchets up another step and say he has the God, he's the God of hosts, of anything, everything, every being of ultimate power. So the new translation relationship, really, new translation shows the power of God, who has all forces of nature under control. And once again, it's just that term, hosts. So when we think of hosts, it's the host of angels, what they're referring to here. And like I said, goes back to Isaiah. Just a couple of quick things, and we'll wrap it up here. Consecration, we'll now use, it's not in your notes there, but we'll use the word chalice instead of cup, which will really elevate what, I have cups of coffee, and there's the Stanley Cup, there's lots of cups. We say the cup at Mass, it really doesn't do it justice. So it brings on, the new word is chalice, which really in the God, or in the Bible, really there's the chalice is used for specific important times. You'll see it throughout. So the chalice, the cup now has been elevated to, we call it now the chalice. The last thing I'd like to really go through is a couple things that are really, it's the Lamb of God. The whole Lamb, Ecce Agnus Dei, behold the Lamb of God. Once again, the actual term is Ecce, which is behold, as opposed to this is. And this, remember when John the Baptist had Jesus came to be baptized, he said, behold the Lamb of God. And the terminology they have in there is blessed versus happy. And what we want to point out there is the actual term, the phrase that they used. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. And our priest will say that to us, blessed as opposed to happy. That's quite a difference between the verbiage there. And the reason we do this is to, it's a, that term, the blood, that phrase, blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb, comes from Revelations, and it talks about that we are all invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. In other words, the priest is echoing, blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Behold the Lamb of God. He's echoing what the angels said in Revelations. In other words, the angels in John's vision, he said to John, write down that blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. But that's what the angels told John to write down. And the priest is just echoing the words of the angels. And throughout, the reason I bring this up is this really depicts our relationship with Jesus, that we are entering into a wedding feast at the Mass. And this is, if you will, our invitation to come to the wedding. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. In other words, we're being invited to come to the supper of the Lamb, the Eucharist. And Jesus is the bridegroom. And as we go down the rows to go to communion, we're literally entering into that wedding feast as the bride. And then we are receiving the bridegroom. And in the marital sense, we are consummating our marriage. So that this particular text, I mean, if you go through Revelation, they really have a lot of emphasis on the marriage feast. And that's what Scott Hahn does, is he shows how the Revelations actually talks about the whole Mass as this big marriage feast. And it's consummated literally when we receive Jesus. So this time when Father says to us, behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world, blessed are those, us, that are called to the supper of the Lamb. And that's really our invitation. Please come to receive the bridegroom. So that's this particular verbiage. Now the difference is, doesn't blessed sound a little bit more as an invitation as opposed to happy? I mean, we don't necessarily have to be happy to be holy or blessed. So that's the only other thing I want to mention too is the Lord, I'm not worthy, our response, that you should enter under my roof, which goes back to the original text again, as opposed to receive you. What does that remind you of? Centurion? What happened there? Okay. It's a story of the centurion. This is a direct quote from that. Once again, try and bring scriptures into this. When you hear the response to receive you, you could never guess what the text is. So when they say you should enter into my roof, we're talking about our beings, in other words, entering into my soul. And just like the centurion, who was not only very faithful, he had a lot of faith, he's also very very strong, and he believed that Jesus had that power of him. But he's also very humble because he said, you don't have to come under my roof because you can do it wherever you want. You don't have to come to my house, or to my servant's house. So he's not only had faith, but he was also very humble. And that's where, as we're preparing to receive Jesus, this is our challenge. He said, Lord, I'm not worthy that you should enter under my roof within me. But only say the word, and my soul, not I, but my soul. So this little interchange here, right before we go to communion, is really what it's all about, in terms of what we're about to enter into. The last check, are we really ready to receive Jesus? Are we prepared to receive him? If we're not, we said, I'm sorry at the beginning, We have another opportunity now to say, Lord, you say the word, and my soul will be healed. So that this really is a this whole interchange has changed in my perspective. It's really become more alive. You hear, behold, blessed, and under my roof, and my soul. And those words change this whole interchange. So we just kind of rolled off the tongue. Okay. So there's a lot more changes that you have with you there. We could go on for a couple more hours, but we could be thrown out of here over here. So where do we go from here? We talked about, if those of you who have gone to Mass in the last few days, you know, in a few pockets, we have some 8.5 by 11 sheets that have the glory on it, under this particular prayer. We are going to start singing the Mass parts starting this Sunday, and we'll practice before Mass, and we'll sing the Gloria, the Holy, Holy, the Sanctus, and the Agnus Dei. Anything else? The acclamation.
This
weekend. Right. Yeah, we're going to eventually do it. It's going to be 5 weeks. We're doing it eventually. In other words, we're going to go through the whole card. And we're going to, this weekend, we're going to be singing the new Gloria. So we can gradually get into it. And like Deacon Sam said, you've been given the authority to do that. And we're going to be doing it. The whole full thruster was October 23rd, our 110th anniversary. That's when we'd hope to have everybody in, all be singing all the parts. So when the bishop came, Archbishop came, well, he was scheduled to come, believe it or not. And we hope to have this great, you know, great presentation of the new songs. But it's still our 110th, and it's a joyous time. So we're going to be preparing. So before every Mass, we'll spend 5 minutes. We're going to learn the new songs together. You have cards in front of you, so you'll pick that up. So, any questions? Yes, ma'am.
We used to say, creator of heaven and earth. Then they went to maker of heaven and earth, and they didn't change it back. It's still maker of heaven and earth. Any insight on why it was? Because it always bothered me a lot that we went from creator to maker of heaven and earth.
Were you here for the first session?
Yes.
But I'm sure they answered it then. Because they were talking about God. So ask Father. Well, there she is. She's right there. Mary Beth. Ask Mary Beth.
Well, I didn't talk about the creation. I'm just looking at it because I never noticed that.
Where is it?
The Nicene says maker, the apostle says creator. So it's been that way for a long time.
Keep everybody happy. Of course, the Apostles' Creed was written in a different text. So.
But do you remember we used to say creator of heaven and earth and not maker of heaven and earth? And then they changed it to maker. But they didn't change it this time when they cleaned it up, and I'm just trying to find some insight.
The Latin for the Nicene Creed is factorum, too. Factorum.
Yeah, it's the difference between, he's absolutely right. We have two creeds, the Apostles' Creed, which is the oldest, it dates from the probably first century, and the Nicene Creed, which dates from the fourth century. The Apostles' Creed uses creator, and the Nicene Creed uses maker, factorum and creator. It's two different creeds. And sometimes you do pray the Apostles' Creed at Mass. The creed we pray, the rosary, sometimes at Mass, so we get both sometimes.
Those who are praying the rosary while we're in the middle of Mass. Just don't interchange that. Yes, Debbie.
Gloria, will we be invited to sing the entire Gloria, or will our cantors do like a phrase and then let us sing the little phrase and then they continue with all the rest of it?
You know, it's interesting you say that, because we never have not been allowed to do that. We have assumed that ourselves. It's our fault. We're the ones that should be singing all along. Now, the new master, or the song versions, settings are going to be non, what's the term, responsorial in nature. They're going to be just the whole text. We've been trying, on some of the masses we've been doing now, we've been trying to do a straight gloria. So, I mean, but we are supposed to be singing all along. So, now you don't have any reason to hold back. Because, matter of fact, the canons are going to insist that you sing along. And that's really what, like this is it's an acclamation, it's a praise of God. You know, let's prove it. You know, that the church should be rocking at that time. Because we're praising God. As a, you know, we need to get involved.